2 seconds. Divide that, you get 5 × 10⁻². If we go on, we are going to have, now we have our area one, we have area one, we have area two, and we have our velocity one. Now V2 is going to be equal to area one, which is 1.5 × 10⁻⁴ in meters, over area two, which is 1.5 × 10⁻⁶, multiplied by velocity one, which is 5 × 10⁻². Now we are going to have that being that is 1.5 × 5 × you add the powers from the law of indices, that is going to be 10⁻⁶ over 1.5 × 10⁻⁶. These two will cross and then we'll go. We will remain with 5 meters, or in terms of centimeters, that is going to be 500 centimeters. So that was what was expected out of you. Next, that was a question on the linear motion. The question on linear motion, the graph of linear motion, I've indicated always that in physics, the gradient is going to carry a meaning. And for you to describe a motion, always what you require is to describe the velocity, gradient. Now, what I said, or in math, we know that a graph that is having a straight line, that like that one, gradient is constant. So it is having a constant gradient. A graph, and this gradient is positive. So that is the critical thing about it. For a graph that is also moving in this direction, constant, gradient is constant. Gradient is constant, but now it is negative. Rather, it means either negative here in physics will mean two things. If the gradient is going to be negative, it will mean two things. Either the direction of motion has changed from the initial, or the variable here, which could be velocity or the acceleration, is decreasing. So negative means two things there. Decrease in the variable, which it will be either the velocity is decreasing or acceleration is decreasing. Now, so that is the type of graph. Then we have these other two graphs. We have the graph that is moving in this direction, and then we will have a graph that moves in this direction. Then, yeah, so, and again here, we can also have a graph that moves in that particular direction. Now, so we have, let's say this is our graph one, this is our graph two, this is our graph three, this is our graph four, this is our graph five. Now, basically, these are the common type of graph that we are going to meet under motion. Now, I've said here, the gradient is constant. So what all you need to describe in the motion is just look at the gradient. Assume, for example, if this graph, it was this distance or displacement against time, we know change, if we find the gradient for displacement change in time, that is going to give us a velocity. Therefore, what means that if the gradient is constant and the gradient here represents the velocity, then it means that the velocity at this for this motion is constant. So you describe this motion as a body move with a constant velocity. For this second case, if we are not, it is not a velocity time graph, if it is a velocity time graph, we know if we find the gradient of this graph, that will be changed in velocity, or which is on the y-axis, over change in time, and that actually will give us acceleration. So, because we know such graph, the gradient is constant, acceleration is going to, it means that acceleration is constant. So we describe that motion that a body moves with a constant acceleration. So gradient always guide you when you're describing the type of motion. Now, let me get back to graph three. This graph here, we basically, they have a non-uniform gradient, or the gradient is not same at every given point. So such kind of graph, we usually determine the gradient. You can take 2 points toward the end and at the beginning. Those 2 points, find the gradient at this point and find the gradient at this other point. Now, if you look at this graph here, at this point, the graph is steeper than at this particular point. So it means that at this point, the gradient is higher than at this point, the gradient is lower. And because the graph is moving, sloping towards the right hand, then it means this gradient, again, they are all negative. Now, if you look at that graph now, it means that if we were able to get the gradient, it means that the gradient, because it was high and it is coming low, so the gradient is decreasing. For this graph, the gradient is decreasing, which means that if the gradient is decreasing, because if you determine it from the beginning toward the end, the gradient is the gradient keep reducing, because at this point you're going to get it lower than at this point, and it is negative. Now, assume this is a graph of a velocity time, let's start with the displacement time. If this is a graph of displacement against time, then we know that the gradient here is going to be velocity. So what it means that the body is having a high velocity at this point than at this the second point. So it means that the body started with a high velocity, then it moved with a lower velocity. So if I'm to describe that motion, I'll say the body is moving with a decreasing velocity. So we'll say the body is moving with a decreasing velocity. Now, that motion, we have described it. If it was, for example, if this was a velocity time graph and it is looking this way, if it is a velocity time graph, then we know that the gradient here is going to be acceleration. So that will mean that at this point, acceleration is high, and at this point, acceleration is low. So it means that it started with a high acceleration, then it reduced its acceleration. And if, because it is negative, we're going to say the body is moving with decreasing acceleration, which if the acceleration is decreasing, then automatically the body is decreasing. So if it is a velocity time graph, then it is going to be body is moving with a decreasing acceleration. Graph four, same interpretation as this, the same as this graph, only that now this is a negative. Now, if you look at how I said you take a point close to the beginning and also towards the end. Now, if you draw a tangent at that point and you draw a tangent at that point and determine the gradient, you'll find at this point the gradient is higher than at this point. Or rather, the graph is steeper, that means it is more of vertical than at the second point. So, still that means that the body is started with a high gradient and the gradient decreases. So what we know, the gradient is what we're going to interpret our linear graph. So we're going to have, at this particular point, we're going to say, body move, if it is displacement against time, then we know that the gradient here is going to be velocity. And if it is velocity, then it means the velocity is high when the body started, then it reduced. So we are going to describe the motion as the body moves with a decreasing velocity. So the body is going to move with a decreasing velocity. If the same was on the velocity time graph, then actually it means that the acceleration at this point is higher, sorry, this is supposed to be low, is higher, the acceleration at this point is higher than the acceleration at this point. So therefore, the body is moving with a decreasing acceleration. That is graph 4. Graph 5 is still, the gradient is not a straight line. Therefore, it is going to have infinite gradient, or rather the gradient will keep changing. So I just pick the point at the beginning, and then I pick the point close to the end. If it was a graph and I was to get to the gradient, I'll draw a tangent there, and then I'll draw a tangent at this point. Now, at this point here, you will find the graph is gently sloping, or it is more horizontal than at the second point. So at this point, we expect the gradient to be higher, and then at this point, we expect the gradient to be lower. So if it started with a lower, it is lower, then it moved to higher. If it is a displacement time graph, then we know that the gradient here is going to be velocity. So we are going to say that velocity, so we expect the velocity was lower when the body started, and then the velocity increased or become higher. So we are going to say the body moved with increasing velocity. If it was velocity time graph, if it is a velocity time graph, then you will see the body is gradient is going to be acceleration. So the body will start, but the body had a lower acceleration, then acceleration increases. So we can rather describe this motion as the body move with an increasing acceleration. And these basically are the key principle of what we just mean. So with describing the motion, you need to know what type of the graph am I supposed to have, and what do the gradient represent here. Now back to the question you had, it is asking you sketch a velocity time graph for a body that is uniformly accelerating. Uniformly means it is constant. And if it is constant, uniformly accelerating, now we will look, velocity time graph will give you, its gradient will give you an acceleration. And from there, if it is uniform, then it is having a constant gradient. Therefore, your graph was supposed to look like the first graph. So now, that graph was carrying one mark. And I know some of you just decided to do this. Yeah? Okay. I was giving a zero for such a case, because I've always said that just labeling, once you have your graph, if you're doing any, every time you're going to do a physics graph, Zubair, I hope you're listening to this. Every time you're going to do your graph, draw the y-axis, then draw the x-axis. If like this case, we don't require the negative part, so we only require the positive. So once you have drawn those two lines, label them first. Now, if they were to be scaled, decide which scale are you going to use. Okay, for this case, we don't need the scale. So there was no mark for scale. Also, there's no plotting. So once you have done these two, tell us or indicate what is on the y-axis. Once you have done this, so show us, like for this case, we know time is an independent variable. And every time you are going to graph make a graph of time against any other variable, time always go on the x-axis. So that is where we are going to have our time. And in physics, again, you have to indicate the units. So time, we know, always is in seconds. So you do that, and then you go to velocity, and velocity also, you do that. And velocity, we know, is in meter per second. So you indicate the unit. Then from there, just draw your straight line with a ruler, not freehand. So with that, now I give you a one mark. without showing which variable is here and the other variable is there, all the marks go. Now, that was question 10. And now I know you know what to expect or what to do with the linear equations. Question 11. A high jumper load on a sawdust. Explain how the dust helps in reducing the force of impact. Now, this is a topic that we just did before we took a break. And an impact force, remember we said, that is the force that is going to act in a body within a very short time. So, the force we said is given as mv minus mu over t. Now, if mv minus mu is the force is acting within very short time, you will find that if time is small, or the lower the time, the smaller the time, the higher this force is going to be. Because, like, if we were to able to solve this upper part, let's assume that the mv minus mu is 5. So we keep it constant and we take it against time of 2 seconds. And then again, the same, it is acting within a very short time. That is 1 second. You will find that the impact force here is 5 and the impact force here is 2.5. So the longer the time, the lower the impact force. The smaller the time, the higher the impact force. So if you look at that, a high jump it was supposed to be land on a sawdust. Explain how the sawdust particle helped reducing the force of impact. You see, the sawdust here, if let's say this person is jumping from this point, this particular point, and so he's jumping and his landing position, he is supposed is going to offer. So it will take, as if he just jumped without the sawdust, you will find he's going to take a very short time to land or to reach the ground. But if we put some sawdust here, because this sawdust is going to offer some resistance, is going to take more time. So if it's going to take more time, it is going to reduce the impact force. So we say the sawdust, so the answer to that was supposed to be the sawdust offer resistance, increasing landing time, hence decrease in impact force, and that is what was expected from that. So it's just about the impact force, which we know is high when the time taken to produce it is small. Next question, that was a question on still under the same subtopic. A bullet of mass moving with a velocity of 30 meters per second penetrates a sandbag and is brought to rest in 0.5 seconds. Find the average retarding force of the sand. Now, a bullet of mass moving with a velocity of 30 meters per second penetrate a sandbag and is brought to rest in 0.5. Find the average retarding force of the sand. That was so direct. But okay, we know always we are going to have the sorry Now, from there, we have the body with a mass. We know force is given as mass times acceleration. And this, from the this formula, we know that acceleration, so this is, can be m, v minus u divided by t. And then from there, we are looking at the retarding force, or the impact force, the force that brought him to rest. We are calling it retarding force because it is reducing, this force is bringing the person to rest. That is why we are calling it a retarding force, or rather it means that he is retardating. To retardate is to decrease in acceleration, or rather to bring something to rest. So from there, we have our mass, we have our initial velocity, because the body, the bullet was moving with 30 meters per second. So that will be our initial velocity, and then it was brought to rest. So the final velocity is zero. So we know M, it is always good to arrange them. M is 20 grams. Grams. So we change it to kilograms. That will be 10 raised to negative 3 kg. Our U is 30 meter per second. Our V is zero. Our V is final velocity because it was brought to rest. And our T, that is 0.05 seconds. So from there, if we substitute back in the formula, we are just going to have force, retarding force is equal to mass, which is 20 times 10 raised to negative 3. V is 0 minus 30 divided by 0.05. And from there, we're going to have, that is, if you solve that, that is 20 times 10 raised to negative 3 times negative 30 over 0.05. And then the answer you get is going to be negative something newtons. Now the answer is coming to negative because it is a retarding force. It is acting in an opposite direction to the direction the bullet is moving. So if the bullet was moving in this particular direction, that retarding force must be acting in an opposite direction, and that is why our final answer comes to be negative. And if you solve out that, you are going to get negative 12 newtons. Next question, that is question 13, and question 13 is asking you to state Hooke's law for a spiral spring. Remember, I have always said, wait a minute, that the law is like a principle, but what makes it to be a law, it must have a condition at the end. So if you're stating a law, it must be having a condition at the end. And you don't need to cram the entire statement of the law, but look at what is the condition after the principle or the rule that you're being given. So you just need to state the basic term and then with the condition. For example, the Hooke's law. Hooke's law, we know, relate extend the force producing extension with extension, which usually say that the force producing extension is going to be directly proportional. They are directly proportional, provided. Now that is the condition. Provided you don't exceed elastic limit. Now, simply with a graph, this is what Hooke's law says or holds, that if you do the graphing of extension against force, then force in Newton and extension in millimeter, for example, then this, as if you increase the force, the extension is going to increase. Now, it will get to a point where an increase on force will not produce a proportional extension, but will make this body now move permanently and not change. Then it will get to a point where now it will no longer extend and it will break. Now, from this point up to there, that is what we call elastic limit. Elastic limit. And the Hooke's law only hold between here. Remember I said a law is something that is going to have a boundary. For example, a law that is actually being used in Kenya cannot be used like in Europe. So that law, Hooke's law, will only apply between elastic limit. First elastic limit, the law becomes invalid, and then at that point from here, that is what we call the plastic limit, where increase in force is going to cause a permanent change. Then from the plastic region or the plastic zone, then the point where it just breaks, we call it the yield point. That is where any further increase in force, the material can no longer support it, and then it will break. So Hooke's law apply here, and the Hooke's law says that for a helical spring or stretchable material or stretchable material, force, or rather applied force, produces or is directly proportional, force is directly, so the first point is force, and a helical spring or elastic, a stretchable material or just elastic body. For elastic body, we have the word helical spring. That is what we will look at in your statement. Elastic material force is directly proportional to extension. So these two words are not supposed to meet in your statement. Up to there, now then, the condition applies that provided, now you see this limit, you provided elastic limit is not exceeded. Elastic limit is not exceeded. You can as well say within the elastic limit. So those are the key points that you look at.
You are there first.
So I think up to there I'll conclude. So if up to what we have revised, if you have any question, I think next week you can bring it before the start of the lesson. From tomorrow, we'll continue with our normal notes. Or from next week, that is on Tuesday. Yeah.